Hi, everyone. I'm in the Fire Tower in Oranog Park in Woodbury, Connecticut. And the views here are spectacular. This tower stands 80 feet and was built in 1911 as a lookout for forest fires in the Pomerog Valley. Now it sits in Oranog Park. The park is on the high ridge of Trap Rock Cliffs that run to the west of Main Street in Woodbury. And Oranog is the native name for these cliffs. Before the steel tower, there stood a simpler wooden tower built by Woodbury native William Cothran. Cothran wrote the beautifully illustrated History of Ancient Woodbury, first published in 1854. And it's from William Cothran's book that the next story comes. But first, I have to climb down and hike to the west side of the park. This is Bethel Rock. It's a large rock face that forms a natural amphitheater in this clearing in the woods. And this spot is of historical importance for the town of Woodbury. Woodbury was settled in 1659 when the Reverend Zechariah Walker and a small group of followers split from their main church in Stratford. And here at Bethel Rock, Reverend Walker held the town's first religious services while their church was being built. Bethel Rock provided some shelter and security for the early founders. But in William Cothran's History of Ancient Woodbury, there is also a legend attached to this place, the legend of Bethel Rock.
Some 10 years after the return of the inhabitants to Woodbury from their enforced residence in Stratford during King Philip's War, it is related that Waromaki, a young Pututuck sachem, fell in love with Sarah Walker, a young girl of 17 years, a niece of the venerable pastor, who was in Woodbury on a visit to her uncle of some months' duration. He was a youth of manly proportions, of graceful figure, and finely molded limbs. He was far in advance of the other Indians in intelligence, and in all of the manly virtues, and, from their return from Stratford, an unwavering friend of the white settlers. It seemed to be his ambition to adopt their habits and costumes, and in the end, as it turned out, he sought matrimonial connection with them, aiming to bind in firm alliance and mutual good offices and interests the two races, whose lots in life then seemed cast together. He erected for himself a cabin of unusual elegance, and adopted many of the arts of civilization. He sought the acquaintance of the old pastor and of the other leading citizens, and seemed fully inaugurated in the ways of civilized life. The young lady was a possessor of great personal beauty and womanly attractions. She seemed the rare ideal of feminine loveliness, such as often haunts the dreams of the imaginative and the young, but seldom meets us in the walks of life. She was a type of innocence and purity. She was possessed of unaffected piety and loved to wander in the beautiful sylvan retreats in the vicinity of the village. For the quiet contemplation of nature and private devotion, she often, at sunset hour, retired by the shady path from her uncle's house to the overhanging mossy cliff of Bethel Rock. It was natural for the romantic and religious child to wander to the place of prayer frequented by all the people at stated intervals. Waromaki was often at the pastor's house, and became more and more enamored of his niece. Not yet having forgotten the aboriginal custom of wooing, he brought many a rich and rare present, and lay at her feet to win her favor. But she, understanding their import and being unimpressed by the fervor of his passion, declined them all, with dignity and kindness, desiring to give no offense to arouse his anger. Meeting with no success with the maiden, he pressed his suit upon the uncle, desiring his good offices on his behalf. The old pastor tried to show him the impropriety of the alliance and declined to influence his niece to accept the marriage proposed. Yet he did this with great kindness as well as firmness, for it was a matter of first importance to all the settlers to be on friendly and intimate terms with the Indians. Thus failing, on all hands, in the prosecution of his suit, he departed and was seen no more at the parsonage. His proud nature could not endure the slight put upon him, the leader of the Red Men. No offer of violence followed, and the pastor's household was for some time in doubt as to what might result from this unfortunate attachment on the Indians' part. though revenge was feared. One delightful evening in the gorgeous Indian summer, the young girl left her home, as usual, for Bethel Rock, just as the sun set behind the western hills, to engage in her evening meditation and devotion, but failed to return. Next morning, after diligent search had been made, her dead body was discovered at the foot of the rock, mangled by the fall, but with her limbs decently arranged, her hands folded, and her clothing wrapped carefully about her. Beside her was a lifeless body of the chieftain, evidently lying just as he had fallen from the cliff. It is supposed that after she reached the top of the rock, she saw Waramaki, who had followed her to this retreat, and supposing him still angry and coming to wreak his vengeance, started back in alarm, falling from the great height upon the jagged rocks below, and was killed by the fall. By a secure path, the chief reached the scene below, and finding her dead, he adjusted the form and dress in a comely way, reascended the rock, and sought death by casting himself from the dizzy height upon the rocks by her side, thus atoning his responsibility for the occurrence by sharing her fate.
Now, there is no historical documentation to support this story, so the legend of Bethel Rock is really just local lore. But it's a story that has stood the test of time. And although there is no evidence that Reverend Zechariah Walker ever had a niece named Sarah, the Reverend was very much a real person. And his grave still lies in the South Cemetery in Woodbury. And the sachem, Waramaquig's mark, is on some of the town's early deeds. In any case, the legend of Bethel Rock was well known enough in William Cawthron's time that he felt the need to include it in his book, The History of Ancient Woodbury. See you next time.